the oldest alphabet. I am going to present to you an article in Science News. This is considered by at least some important people part of science. The oldest alphabet, and it's in the section on language and archaeology, so they consider that as part of science. It's entitled "The Oldest Alphabet Identified as Hebrew." And subtitled "Controversial Claim Argues That Ancient Israelites Turned Egyptian Hieroglyphics into Letters." Controversial why? Well, we'll see. By Bruce Bauer. This is November 19, 2016, so it's fairly recent. This was actually published in their magazine in December of 2016. So that's quite recent. And accompanying the article is a picture of a stone. And the stone is behind you, behind the inscription there. And it says, "Inscriptions in stone slabs from Egypt, including this specimen, dating to almost 3,500 years ago, contain the world's oldest alphabet, which one researcher now argues was an early form of Hebrew. New translations of these inscriptions contain references to figures from the Bible, including Moses." The article begins, "San Antonio, the world's earliest alphabet inscribed on stone slabs at several Egyptian sites was an early form of Hebrew, a controversial new analysis concludes." Why controversial? We will see. "Israelites living in Egypt transformed that civilization's hieroglyphics into Hebrew 1.0 more than 3,800 years ago. At a time when the Old Testament describes Jews living in Egypt, says archaeologist and epigrapher Douglas Petrovich of Wilfrid Laurier University in Waterloo, Canada. Hebrew speakers seeking a way to communicate in writing with other Egyptian Jews simplified the Pharaoh's complex hieroglyphic writing system into 22 alphabetic letters," Petrovich proposed November 17 at the annual meeting of the American Schools of Oriental Research. We will see that this isn't totally controversial. It's just Israelites can't do that. "There is a connection between ancient Egyptian texts and preserved alphabets," Petrovich said. "That's a highly controversial contention among scholars of the Bible and ancient civilizations. Many argue, despite what's recounted in the Old Testament, that Israelites did not live in Egypt as long ago as proposed by Petrovich." That's why the controversy. "Biblical dates for the Israelites' stay in Egypt are unreliable," they say. And say what? This is another title, and this one will show you the slab, and you can see the faint outlines of a man with his hands raised. And an ox right there, and an eye right there, and a kind of a mushroom-like thing. That's this is ayin, which means eye in Hebrew, by the way. Peh, samek, which is kind of that thing there. It actually means tooth, but in their interpretation, or in some people's interpretation, it means bow. It's drawn as a bow, although why it's open in one end then is not clear. But anyway, this is a hand, which is kaf, and this is a courtyard, I think, which is cheth. Anyway, here's another aleph, an ox. And so you can see, you know, the difference between that aleph and that aleph. You can recognize the two, but they're not as neatly done as we do nowadays. Alphabetic inscriptions on an ancient stone slab have been identified by researchers Hebrew and translated. A drawing of the slab's inscriptions show early Hebrew letters next to corresponding modern Hebrew letters. Inscriptions along the left edge of the slab translate as, "The one having been elevated is weary to forget." Inscriptions along the top translate as, "The overseer of minerals, Ahisamach." And here's their courtyard again, by the way. Notice that there's a little difference between those two. Scholars have also generally assumed that for more than 150 years that the oldest alphabetic script Petrovich studied could be based on any of a group of ancient Semitic languages, but not enough is known about those tongues to specify one language in particular. Could be Hebrew, could be Ugaritic, it could be, Aramaic, who knows. Petrovich's Hebrew identification for the ancient inscription is starved for evidence, said biblical scholar and Semitic languages specialist Christopher Rolson of George Washington University. There is no way to tell which of the many Semitic languages are represented by the early alphabetic system, Rolson contended. The origins of writing in different parts of the world, including that of the alphabet carved into the Egyptian slabs, have long stimulated scholarly debates. So this is not new stuff. A German scholar identified the ancient Egyptian writing as Hebrew in the 1920s, but he failed to identify many letters in the alphabet, leading to implausible translations that were rejected by researchers. Also, he must have been wrong because Israelites didn't exist back that far. Petrovich said his big break came in January of 2012. While conducting research at the Egyptian Museum in Cairo, he came across the word Hebrews in a text from 1874 BC that included the earliest known alphabetic letter. According to the Old Testament, Israelites spent 434 years in Egypt from 1876 to 1442 BC. So, this is about the time that they would normally come into Egypt. Now, what happens if the Egyptians are made too old? Well, in that case, the Israelites were already in Egypt. Petrovich then combined previous identifications of some letters in the ancient alphabet with his own identifications of disputed letters to peg the script as Hebrew. Armed with the entire fledgling alphabet, he translated 18 Hebrew inscriptions from three Egyptian sites. And he presented it to the American Schools of Oriental Research, as we'll see. Several biblical figures turn up in the translated inscriptions, including Joseph, who was sold into slavery by his half-brothers and then became a powerful political figure in Egypt, Joseph's wife, Asenath, and Joseph's son, Manasseh, a leading figure in a turquoise mining business that involved yearly trips to Egypt's Sinai Peninsula, where some of the inscriptions are found. Moses, who led the Israelites out of Egypt, is also mentioned, Petrovich says. Moses was a historical figure in that case. You can see why people who have been skeptical of the biblical story would be skeptical of this interpretation. One inscription dated to 1834 BC translates as, "Wine is more abundant than the daylight, than the baker, than a nobleman." This statement probably means that at that time or shortly before, drink was plentiful, but food was scarce, Petrovich suspects. Israelites, including Joseph and his family, likely moved to Egypt during a time of famine when Egyptians were building silos to store food, he suggests. And this is some of the letters in, kind of drawn form. You can see the ox. And you can see the Middle Egyptian hieroglyphics is very similar. That's Aleph, ancestor to our today's A. And we're going to see some more of that kind of stuff. That'll be more detailed. The the corner here and the corner here, and you can see they're very similar. And that's Gimel. Even though it's interesting because it's Gimel, I believe, means camel. But they didn't draw it as a camel. This is Hay, foreman, holding up his hands, saying hey or hoy, or depending on where you read it from. And of course, the hieroglyphics don't have vowels, so you can put whatever vowel you want to after that. And this one is water. It's a stream meandering back and forth, or perhaps waves. You can visualize it either way. And in any case, it's mayim, Hebrew mayim, which of course gives our modern M, and gives the, they still have mem in Hebrew. And this is an eye, which looks very similar to the Egyptian eye, and that's ayin. This no, it's actually a ah. It's kind of like a ha, only you voice it. And it's very hard to hear for Westerners, and it's been hard to hear for some Jewish people. And so a lot of times it gets omitted, and it's been, in fact, kind of used for an O, which is the letter that descended from it in the Greek and therefore the Latin alphabet. Citations. Dr. D. Petrovich, Hebrew is the world's oldest alphabet. Annual meeting of the American Schools of Oriental Research, San Antonio, November 17, 2016. So, yes, this was actually presented. Obviously not to complete acceptance, but you can see the acceptance is partly withheld because Israelites weren't in Egypt at that time. It must have been some other Semitic group. And here's the abstract. First it lists Douglas Petrovich, and then it gives the title. And then this is just the abstract of the talk. So they normally do that. For roughly 150 years, scholars have attempted to isolate the proper Semitic language of the elusive proto-continental script, universally recognized as the world's oldest alphabet. This script is attested at Egyptian sites such as Wadi el-Hol, Lahun, and with the most voluminous amount of witnesses, Sinai Sarabit el-Kadim. Until now, these attempts have been largely unsuccessful, although the meaning of several Semitic words has been identified. While drawings and photographs of these inscriptions have been published, most of the texts have gone untranslated in their various publications. Here it is, and here's a letter, here's a letter, here's a letter, but they haven't put it together. After stumbling across the writing of the word Hebrews in a text that features the earliest attestation of a proto-consonantal letter, the present writer successfully has identified Hebrew as the language of the proto-consonantal script and translated 18 inscriptions of Egyptian Middle Kingdom and New Kingdom eras. Hubert Grimm actually proposed in 1923 that Hebrew is the proper language behind the script. That's apparently our German scholar. But he could not prove this conclusively because he transcribed some pictographs inaccurately and did not know all of the letters of the first alphabet. This presentation will include electronically generated drawings, paleographic observations, and translations of the proto-consonantal Hebrew inscriptions that date to the Middle Kingdom. Sinai 115, Wadi el-Hol 1, Wadi el-Hol 2, and the ceramically datable Lahun bilingual ostracon, ceramically datable. That's presumably doing it with neutron analysis or one of our, you know, thermoluminescence or something like that. All of these inscriptions, they're talking about pottery shards and the shape. All of these inscriptions reflect grammatical conventions and orthographic forms that are perfectly in keeping with an early form of biblical Hebrew. Who is Douglas Petrovich anyway? Well, he's got an MAM, DIV, MTH, and a PhD candidate in ancient Near Eastern archaeology and history. So he hasn't got his PhD yet, but he's working on it. He's hoping he gets it. Douglas was formerly the academic dean and professor at Novosibirsk Biblical Theology Seminary in Siberia. His interests include biblical exegesis, biblical history, Egyptology, ancient Near Eastern history, including archaeology, epigraphy, which is what he's doing now, and iconography. That's looking at images and figuring out what they are and where they belong and how old they are and stuff. He is a contributor for Associates for Biblical Research. His. That should be... That's ungrammatical in English. But so apparently he started out in Russia and then moved to the U.S. or actually to Canada. Now, I'm going to tell you that this is not unusual except for the proposition that the language is Hebrew. I'm just going to pull out something from Biblical Archaeology Review in March and April of 2010, and the person who does this is Ole Goldwasser, and he points out that these things are definitely Semitic, and it's definitely the origin of the alphabet, and it definitely comes from Egypt. And we're going to go through a few of his comments, some of which are probably accurate, and a few of which actually can be demonstrated to be incorrect from the paper itself. And this is subtitled, A Fascinating Account of the Origin of the Alphabet, that's, of course, alphabet in Hebrew, From Egyptian Hieroglyphics to the First Sound Pictures, Hebrew, and Now All Languages. Well, not all languages, but most of them. This article lends credibility to Frank T. Seekin's book, Hebrew Word Pictures, How Does the Hebrew Alphabet Reveal Prophetic Truths? I don't know who Peter is. To the Asiatics, as they were called, and this is the article itself, the lush Nile Delta with its open marshlands rich with fish and fowl was a veritable Garden of Eden. From earliest time, Canaanites and other Asiatics would come and settle here. Indeed, this is the background of the biblical story of the famine in Canaan that led to Jacob's descent into Egypt. And the text is given there. By the beginning of the Egyptian Middle Kingdom, a few years after 2000 BCE, the pressure of immigrants on the eastern delta was so strong that the Egyptian authorities built a series of forts at strategic points to, quote, repel the Asiatics, as the story of Sinuhe tells us. More than a century later, however, Egyptian policy towards the Asiatics changed. Instead of trying to prevent them from coming in, the Egyptians cultivated close relations with strong Canaanite city-states on the Mediterranean coast and allowed select Asiatic populations to settle in the eastern delta. The last of the great pharaohs of the 12th dynasty, Amenemhat III and Amenemhat IV, even established a new town for them. The 12th dynasty was followed by the much weaker 13th dynasty. Thousands of immigrants from Syria, Lebanon, and Canaan then flooded into the eastern delta, creating the large Canaanite settlements that would become Avaris, or modern Tel Eldaba, the capital of the famous Hyksos. The Hyksos were Canaanites who seized power from the Egyptian pharaohs and ruled all Egypt for more than 100 years. But before this, at the end of the 12th dynasty, during the reigns of Amenemhat III and Amenemhat IV, Egypt was at the height of its power. A lively trade was conducted with Nubia to the south. Imports from the Levant entered Egypt by land and sea. Gold and precious stones were quarried in the eastern desert, and a large-scale enterprise was regularly conducted to search for turquoise in the high mountains of southern Sinai at a site today called Serabit El Kadim. So that area is actually in Sinai. Skipping over, I'm not going to read all of this by any stretch. Those of you who are interested can look up the article at the link. Were these miners and workmen Egyptian, Canaanite, both? Skipping on, notice that Israelite is left out of the equation. Why? Because by their chronology, at the most, and probably not that high, Abraham was 1875. So there were no Israelites at this time. So it couldn't have been Hebrew, unless Abraham did it personally. One final note, nowhere in the many inscriptions at the site is there mention of slaves. Canaanites, yes. Slaves, no. It was here at Sarabit, I believe, that the alphabet was invented by Canaanites. The Israelites just took over the writing from the Canaanites. The invention of the alphabet ushered in what was probably the most profound media revolution in history. Earlier writing systems like Egyptian hieroglyphics and Mesopotamian cuneiform with its curious wedge-shaped characters each required a knowledge of hundreds of signs. To write or even read a hieroglyphic or cuneiform text required familiarity with these signs and the complex rules that governed their use, which is why it took us a long time to decipher that. By contrast, an alphabetic writing system uses fewer than 30 signs, in the case of Hebrew, 22, and people need only a few relatively simple reading rules that associate these signs with sounds. Skipping on, but how was it done? Although I believe the alphabet was invented by Canaanites, that we still owe a significant debt to the Egyptians. For it was Egyptian hieroglyphics that provided the trigger and means that made the invention of the alphabet possible. Skipping on, an important key to the decipherment was a unique bilingual inscription. It is inscribed on a small sphinx from the temple and features a short inscription in what appears to be parallel text in Egyptian and in the new script. The Egyptian hieroglyphic inscription on the sphinx reads, "The beloved of Hathor, the mistress of turquoise." The text in the strange script, now identified as a Canaanite text, reads, M, that's actually Ion, H, B, B, Ion, LT, the beloved of Baalat. In just a minute, we're going to show you that. There is the Egyptian hieroglyphics, and here's the Hebrew. And you can see there's your M, the little wiggly line. There's the He, and there's Baal, B, Ion, and L. But it's broken off here, so the T, if there was one, is gone. Here it is, written again from right to left, which is interesting because Hebrew nowadays is all written left to right. But here again, you can say Beth, Ion, and Lamed, and now with a T behind it. Okay, let me just pull those up and make it a little easier for you. This one, that's Mem, Aleph, Heth, and Beth, Ion, Lamed, and Beth, Ion, Lamed, and T. And for those of you wondering, Beth, Ion, Lamed is Baal, more familiar to you by the term Baal. And Baalat is the feminine form. Baal is a god, but it also means master or lord. And Baalat means lady, mistress, the female form of master. And you can see each of the clinical letters is a picture, a house, an eye, an ox goad. I have heard that this is supposed to be really a shepherd's crook, but I'd be interested to know how he figures it's an ox goad. But in any case, it's definitely it's the precursor of Lamed. There's no question about that. The alphabet was invented this way by Canaanites at Sarabit in the Middle Bronze Age in the middle of the 19th century BCE, probably during the reign of Amenemhat III of the 12th dynasty. Well, certainly by the term of Amenemhat III, but we are reasonably confident about the place of the invention because almost all the examples of the new script, which we may now identify by the name scholars call it, proto-Sinaitic, comes from this one site. We are also confident about the time of the invention because there are some very specific connections between the Middle Kingdom, Egyptian hieroglyphics in Sinai, and the new script. There is one hieroglyph that appears to have a special use with very few exceptions only in Egyptian hieroglyphic inscriptions in the Sinai during the Middle Kingdom. We might call this the Sinai hieroglyph. The sign looks like a striding man with bent, upraised arms. In the Egyptian hieroglyphic inscriptions in Sinai, this sign is a logogram. That is, it stands for an entire word, not just part of a word. It probably means something like foreman. This hieroglyph appears dozens of times in Egyptian Middle Kingdom inscriptions at Sarabit. Its phonetic reading in Egyptian in this specific use in Sinai, however, is unknown. This hieroglyph is rare even in later New Kingdom inscriptions at Sarabit, and it hardly ever appears anywhere else in Egypt. So this is special to this time and this place. And here is some drawings of the upraised hands with the walking legs. Those of you who've seen a lot of Egyptian hieroglyphs will recognize, or even the statues, will recognize that it's customary to have the face on and then the legs turned to the side. Moving on, the Canaanites at Sarabit probably connected this pictogram, which they saw everywhere at the site, with a loud call or order emitted by an official when he raised his hands to assemble the people, a typical shout such as hoi, or perhaps hey. Interestingly enough, the name of the Hebrew letter that descended from this, and you can show that, is hey. Which may be the origin of the letter H in the proto-Sinaitic script. We're going to come back to that letter, I think, in just a little bit. If I am correct that the first alphabetic script was invented at Sarabit al-Qadim in the reign of Amenemhat III, I believe I can plausibly explain the process by which it was invented, not by sophisticated scribes, but by comparatively unlettered Asiatic workers. Now, that's the claim he makes, and I think we will see that that claim is actually false. The inventors at Sarabit clearly used models of hieroglyphs taken from the Egyptian Middle Kingdom inscriptions around them. The proto-Sinaitic pictograms were adapted from the hieroglyphic pictograms and appear mostly in the area of the turquoise mines and the roads leading to the mines. It may seem strange, but I believe the inventors of the alphabet were illiterate. It does seem strange, and we're going to see some evidence they weren't. That is, they could not read Egyptian with its hundreds of hieroglyphic signs. Why do I think so? The letters in the proto-Sinaitic inscriptions are very crude. They are not the same size. They are not written in a single direction. Some are written left to right, others right to left, and some top to bottom. This suggests that the writers had mastered neither Egyptian hieroglyphics nor any other complex rule-governed script. Now, that may be true for some, but definitely not for others. And here is some examples of the alphabet. And some of you may recognize some of this. You start with a hieroglyphic, you turn it into proto-Sinaitic. Actually, the first phase has the A upside down. And so the two legs are actually the two horns. Okay? And then it rotated sideways, and then it rotated upside down to where now early Greek will go like that, later Greek will go like that, and Latin, of course, by this time you all recognize the letter. Hieroglyphic has a B that has a square that has a hole out of it. Proto-Sinaitic has a closed square. Then Phoenician and Paleo-Hebrew. And then early Greek, we'll put an extra one to it. And then later Greek, we'll turn it around and turn it into what our modern B is. Those of you who know Greek will recognize that this is beta. Hieroglyphic, you'll notice that you have an Egyptian hieroglyph. You have the proto-Sinaitic, which looks almost the same, just not quite as fancy. And then you have these arms out raised and the head sticking up and then rotating around sideways until it turns into an E. And then early Greek is the same. And then, of course, later Greek flips it around. And we get our modern E. Whereas in Hebrew, it continued on into He eventually. A hand with four fingers, don't ask me why not five, maybe they got lazy, I don't know. Maybe it's like that. Originally doesn't have a hieroglyphic behind it. So somebody came up with that on their own. And then it became kind of a K-like thing. This turned into a tail. Early Greek had it coming this way. Later Greek flipped it around and turned into our Latin and now English K. The Hebrew came down a different way. That's a whole different story because it came from Imperial Aramaic and turned it into Kaf. A hieroglyphic Mem, or M, was just water. Proto-Sinaitic water looked very much the same. Later on, it was kind of done that way, and then a tail added to it. Early Greek is this way. Later Greek turned into standard M and Latin M. And it's Maya, Mem, which you can hear the similarity to Mayim, which is water in Hebrew. An Egyptian snake turned into a proto-Sinaitic snake, turned into something that went up and down and up again, and turned into something very similar in early Greek, but then flipped around to our N that goes the other way, and then finally turned into the Latin N for noon. Probably starting out as not noon, but Nehash, which is the Hebrew for snake. Ayin was the hieroglyphic, the proto-Sinaitic, and then it was simplified to just simply a circle. Phoenician and Paleo-Hebrew, the early Greek, and then finally the later Greek and the Latin, which we recognize as our O. This is just two strokes that are open at the top. But the original Hebrew Hayin was clearly an O. Then we have a head. And you can see, by the way, this is one that you actually know in Hebrew. Rosh Hashanah is head of the year. And it turned into the Hebrew Rosh. The Paleo-Hebrew looked very similar to this, except for the slant of the stem. But it later became what looked more rounded and turned it around, and you have a P, which some of you will recognize as Rho in Greek, and it is also the form of R that is found in Russia, in Cyrillic. But Latin added a tail to it, probably to distinguish it from the P that Latin did differently from the pi of Greek, or more precisely, the P of Greek. Proto-Sinaitic has this. Now he's calling it a bow. It doesn't come from anything in hieroglyphics as far as he knows and as far as I know. And that was actually a tooth originally. And then it becomes, it didn't always have that sharpness to it. There are some scripts that would actually make it kind of an omega, small omega type of look. But in any case, it could become sharp. And of course, if you turn it sideways, you get the Greek sigma, and you can kind of turn this early Greek into Latin S if you want. Interestingly enough, in Cyrillic, it turned into a C. And that's why you see CCCP. It's not really CCCP, it's SSSR. And union apparently starts with S in Russian. So if you have ever seen Soviet uniforms way back when and some of the sports, that's what CCCP was. And then finally you have a T, which, you know, just looks like a cross, and then has been turned sideways, but also some forms will raise it up to the top and turn it into our English T. And of course, again, modern Hebrew has this from the Imperial Aramaic, and so it has a different form. But you can see that all of this stuff, well, most of it came from hieroglyphics, and some of it, the proto-Sinaitics, invented on their own. Now, the only Egyptian inscriptions where the square house is consistently used come from this area of Sinai and from the Middle Kingdom, and appears unequivocally several times in Stela 92, which is probably a hieroglyphic Egyptian text made by Canaanites who were familiar with the proto-Sinaitic inscriptions. They confused the picture of their own house letter with the correct Egyptian hieroglyph. Wait a minute. I thought they were illiterate. Evidently not. Here's the Stele from the article. You can see the Egyptian Beth, which has an opening, it has a door in it, and you can see this particular stele has lots of nice symbols, but their house is closed. Here we do have a couple of open houses, but there's one that's closed as well. So this is somebody who sees both forms being roughly equivalent. But it's obviously also somebody who is literate. So this whole premise that these people were illiterate is demonstrably false in at least one case. During the 9th century, I'm skipping way down, the alphabet became the official script of the entire Near East. With its adoption first for Greek and later for Latin, the alphabetic script invented in the milieu of Canaanite miners in the remote Sinai desert became the script of Western civilization. The alphabet was invented only once. All alphabetic scripts derived from this original one, which we may call the Serbet alphabetic script. Now, this is where I know this guy is at least partly deficient in his understanding. And the reason I say that is because Korean also has an alphabet. And the Korean alphabet is derived from Chinese characters, simplified in much the same way. Interestingly, not by some illiterate person, but by the king of Korea, at least that's the story. It's possible that one of his courtiers came up with it, and the king thought it was such a good idea that he took credit for it. That's been done before. But in any case, it was somebody who was, in fact, literate. So take that idea that these people were illiterate with a grain of salt. In the discussion, it says, because this article was published in Biblical Archaeology Review, and then they did something later on which allowed for discussion of the subject, with somebody saying, oh no, you missed this and this, and then the original author can come back and say stuff. It says, if Hamilton is correct that the Sa'di is a simplistic representation of the hieroglyph of the clump of papyrus pictured at right, the emblem of Lower Egypt, and it looks like it's probably true, it strongly relates our Canaanites to the Delta area. Such a sign would be meaningless for Canaanites residing outside of Egypt. This fact was acknowledged by Hamilton, who indeed suggested that the inventors came from the region of Tel el-Daba. That's where all those Asiatics used to live. Now, my take is that most of what Petrovich says is not that controversial. The alphabet did originate during the Middle Kingdom in either Egypt or the Sinai. But if it was in the Sinai, it was by people who knew about Egypt because they took Sa'di straight out of papyrus. The alphabet originated in around the Sinai Peninsula during the 12th dynasty by Semitic people. There's really no controversy there. His controversial argument is that the people were Hebrews. The name Moses shows up, as does Joseph. This would imply that the alphabet originated just in time for Moses to use it to write the books of Moses. It also implies that the alphabet was invented by somebody or some peoples. I didn't write that correctly. One or more people that knew of, or perhaps knew, probably knew, hieroglyphics. Apparently Moses was a reasonable name to give a Semitic person, although you wouldn't expect that. Moses is really influenced by Egyptian. And it would also imply that it is possible that Moses invented the alphabet for the express purpose of writing the first five books of the Old Testament, the Tanakh. Now, and probably Job too, for what it's worth. It's interesting because that is what the Israelite legends said. Moses invented the alphabet. But you see, if you're a skeptic, you can't do that. First of all, maybe the Israelites never came out of Egypt. Or if they did, they came out under the reign of Ramesses, which is way too late. And so the alphabet was invented way before them. Well, of course, that destroys the argument that the JEDP theory must be correct because Moses couldn't have written it because there was no alphabet back then. In fact, originally it was argued that there was no writing then. But, you know, of course, the that's been proven false a long time ago. But now it's that the alphabet wasn't invented, so he couldn't have written the book. Well, of course, he could have translated it too, but so now we've got an argument that Moses actually invented the alphabet. Well, is that strange? Not really, and here's why. If you think about it, the first book to ever be translated from one language to another as an entire book, until then you had to learn the language to read the book, was the Old Testament. It was translated from Hebrew into Greek, called the Septuagint. Saint Cyril actually invented an alphabet in order to translate the Bible into Russian. So innovation to get the Bible in front of people has been going on for a long time and is historic. Now, if you take this far enough, Petrovich's ideas, it implies that Joseph and Moses should be located in the 12th dynasty and that perhaps the fall of the Middle Kingdom was when the Israelites left and the Pharaoh got killed. Perhaps the rearrangements of people like Velikovsky, Kerville, or David Roll need to be taken more seriously than they currently are. And I will remind you that the objection to this kind of thing comes from people who are skeptical. Many argue, I'm quoting from the original article, well, the original article that we've talked about, many argue, despite what's recounted in the Old Testament, that Israelites did not live in Egypt as long ago as proposed by Petrovich. Biblical dates for the Israelites' stay in Egypt are unreliable, they say. So what you're seeing is a theory that is trumping the evidence in front of our eyes. At least that's what it appears. Now, I will have to be fair. I have not read the book by Petrovich, which has just come out, and you can't get it, at least I couldn't find it in the usual places I looked. And apparently it costs $80, although I'll probably spring for that. It'll be interesting to see what the exact evidence that he had was. But as you can see, this appears to be an area where the empirical evidence appears to be in favor of a conservative interpretation of the Bible, and the skeptics really don't like it. But that's my opinion, and now it's your turn. We have a couple of comments, but first, no, you go ahead first.
It's interesting that this Fox News carried this on December 5. I just found it online.
Yeah.
They put the thing out, but Fox News is the one that did it.
I think a lot of people who put it out don't realize what the issues are, and therefore are going to be surprised at why is everybody so upset about Petrovich's findings. And the reason why is because it implies things that they don't want to believe.
Fox News seems to agree with Petrovich, just as what I read through here.
Well, some of that, I think, people don't realize the implications of this. Anyway, a couple back here. Let's pass the mic back.
Do you have any idea what at what point in Moses' life that the Bible, the first five books written, or first however many books?
Well, the picture we get from Ellen White is that he did it while he was in the wilderness after he had killed the Egyptian and ran off. I went through the stuff one time and I could not find the exact age that he killed the Egyptian. It's, I think, traditionally 40, but I couldn't find biblical support for that. I do know that when he came back, he was 80. And he died at 120. Well, that's an interesting question. If you follow the biblical record, the Exodus is 1445. Mm-hmm. And if you believe Egyptian chronology, then that was during the reign of Thutmose III or Amenhotep II, in depending on what you do with 4 years there, in Egyptian chronology. But that was near the height of the Egyptian Empire, and it's hard to visualize the Egyptians managing through the loss of all their crops, the loss of their cattle, or even a substantial portion of their cattle, the loss of their army, and the loss of the pharaoh. And it's pretty much unquestionable that the pharaoh died in the Red Sea. And in fact, that fact has inspired some people to try to see if we can make this Thutmose III died in the Red Sea. Because we have his body, and somebody would have had to go out and get it. But it makes much more sense to put it in the last pharaoh of the 12th dynasty, whose body was never found, and whose widow ruled for 5 years over a piece of Egypt after that, but apparently didn't do too much else. And one of these days, if I have the chance and he is willing to come and be filmed, I will have Brad Sparks in, because he has some absolutely fascinating stuff about this. But you see, what this does is this puts Joseph in the 12th dynasty, where there are famine inscriptions of famines for multiple years, and in one case, 7 years. Sometimes it doesn't always say exactly. And so there's a whole bunch of stuff that suddenly will dovetail very nicely. But this, of course, gets really, really uncomfortable if you're trying to say that the Bible is inaccurate, doesn't, you know, misses this, misses that, and therefore you can kind of ignore the miracles that are recorded in it, which is where this really goes. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. But you can see that there's an argument to be made that these inscriptions are in fact Hebrew. They are in fact by Hebrews, some of which had learned the alphabet from Moses, who perhaps had invented it because he was a brilliant man, among other things.
It seems to me as though, I mean, you know, if you look at crime, who has the MO, you know, who has the ability, and it seems to me as though Moses, by the biblical story, he would have been highly educated in the Egyptian hieroglyphs.
Exactly.
And yet, when he clearly cared about the plight of the Hebrews, because he killed, you know, he felt that strongly, and then he had to flee, so he had the free time, and yet his people, I presume, were largely illiterate in hieroglyphs, because it's a difficult thing to learn, and probably what value would slave masters have for having the slaves being able to read? That would not be a normal thing.
Right.
And so he's sitting there.
Their populace didn't read.
What's that?
Their populace didn't read. The Egyptians themselves, unless you were trained as a scribe, you didn't read.
Right. And so here he's in media with plenty of time on his hand, or in the wilderness with plenty of time, and he's he's wanting to be able to share the story with this terribly illiterate people. So how do you make it simple for an illiterate people to be able to read a story and pass it on to their children?
Right.
Well, you put it in a phonetic sort of thing where you can see this character and you can pronounce it, you know.
And you learn 22 characters and you're done.
Yeah, yeah. So it all sort of makes sense.
Well, the teaching somebody a 22-letter alphabet sure beats 150 signs that go all over and sometimes stand for ideas and sometimes stand for sounds. You know, it's a real pain in the neck to learn that system. But if you just have you know, and with Hebrew, all you really need is the consonants, and you can kind of fill in the vowels on your own. Yes, and then we need to go back, okay?
Yeah, it was real quick. In the presentation, it seemed like it was insinuated that Moses was probably a Hebrew name, but then it seemed like it harks back to similar names like Thutmose, and it could be Egyptian. Has anybody thought about that?
Well, no, there's quite a bit of thought to that, and there are a lot of people who say that Moshe is not actually a good Hebrew name before this, and that we would see this afterwards. Moses became popular because, you know, everybody wants to be known named after the really great man. And by the way, that happened all the way along. Joshua became a popular name. Judah became a popular name. Miriam became a popular name. And all the Marys that you hear are actually Miriams. Or to be precise, if you were doing it in Hebrew, it would be Miriam. So Mary and Joseph were named after biblical characters, and But you see this kind of thing where it became popular afterwards, but before it wasn't. And in the surrounding countries, it wasn't popular. So yeah, I think you're seeing Moses pop up because there was an actual historical Moses, and we don't know for sure whether the Moses that's referred to is actual Moses, or whether it's somebody that was named after him, but something in that area. There have been proposals that, you know, these things are hard to date, and perhaps what they are is the Hebrews going through Sinai and, you know, kind of writing Kilroy was here. Yes?
I'm not real familiar with the different dynasties. Were you saying or implying, more likely, that the 12th dynasty was 1400 B.C.?
Basically, that's what I'm saying. The 12th dynasty is conventionally dated. There's a particular tablet of a year of, I think, Sesostris the Third, that has been dated to 1991 B.C. because of some moon things. As it turns out, that can be reinterpreted and has been reinterpreted in literature by a guy by the name of, I think it's Reed, as fitting better with some new moon series in the about 1700 or 1600s or so, which of course would bring that down about 300-400 years. So maybe that guy has a point. And one of the things you have to keep in mind is that Flinders Petrie started dating Egypt by saying that we need to ignore the biblical stuff, we need to look at Egypt itself, and Egypt must have had a very ancient civilization. And he had Mina at 6000 BC. And that got dragged down, kicking and screaming, by the way, to about 3,500 and I think 3,100, and there's some pressure to bring it down further. And so, you know, take all of those dates with a grain of salt. And personally, if you find that the biblical story locks into an Egyptian story that is just supposed to be too old, maybe we should reconsider the date of the Egyptian story. And the end of the Middle Kingdom is an absolutely perfect place to put the Exodus.
I wanted to mention one other observation. When the Israelites had left Egypt, and we have records of how they communicated, generally it was by someone reading the scripture in a mass of people, which I would assume that everyone perhaps couldn't read, and that was the priest and so forth who could read, the educated people. Because if you write a language, if I write a language, it's going to take me a while to teach it to someone else, enough people will understand it. So this was a time process. That probably explains why once a year they'd come and read scripture in public.
Okay, we have another comment here.
Scripture says simply that at the Tower of Babel, God confused the languages and the people went off into different areas with the convenience of their language, what they understood. Everything seems to have happened at once. We have Egyptian hieroglyphics, we have Semitic languages, a plethora of which Hebrew is similar, but we also have Chinese with thousands of characters. And before they made the modernization, you could, like 16 strokes to make one Chinese symbol. And there were thousands of them. What I'm wondering is, where are all the other languages the other possible alphabets from the dispersion of from Babel?
I don't know that I can answer all of that, but I can say that you see there are languages, language families, and that, for example, Chinese and Korean are somewhat similar. And in fact, the pictograms for Chinese for centuries were used in Korea before they developed their own alphabet. Pardon me? And in Japan, it took a different tack, and probably earlier than Korean, where you went from pictograms to a syllabic script that has a consonant and a vowel. And you reduced it from, I don't know, 4,000 or whatever it is, to I think about 200-something in Japan, which is exactly parallel to the reduction of Sumerian, which is on all pictograms, to Akkadian, which is done with the syllabic script. And then finally we get Hebrew, which is the alphabetic script. And so this process has been done at least twice, implying that it's a kind of a natural human tendency to start reducing things to a simpler form, and each time making it easier for people who don't know the script to read it. The one disadvantage is that Chinese, when it has pictograms, if you learn the pictograms, you don't have to actually understand the language, which means that Chinese in Beijing speak differently from Chinese in Shanghai, who speak differently from Chinese in Sichuan. They're actually three different, considered to be three different languages, but they can actually read each other's script, which you can't do very well if you have an alphabetic script. Well, you can, but it's it takes a little more translation. In Chinese, the written language actually works for all three, with basically no more translation than we do for English, who have their trams and we have our buses and, you know, our streetcars. Comment here.
I was talking to a Chinese teacher from Berman University, and he was saying, and I have also read this in an article, that in the Chinese writing there is a lot of similarity to some Christian beliefs. What do you know about that?
Well, actually, Ethel Nelson has written a book, and I don't know, maybe one of these days we'll go and revisit her work and some of the work that's been done since. Ethel Nelson, and I don't remember what the, and it's interesting because it's not Christian in the sense of, you know, Jesus Christ, you know, born in Palestine. It's more of a atonement and God and offerings and stuff, and even things like salvation is eight persons in a boat, which is a fascinating concept if you think about it. What? There's a couple of books, and I don't know the names of them. If you Google Ethel Nelson Chinese, you can probably find out their names on the internet. That's not what? I don't think it has. And if you know of a person who knows Chinese well, I'd love to have them do the presentation, because I'd like to have somebody other than me whose Chinese is limited to Ni Hao Ma and Zhe Zhen.
Dr. Ethel can recommend China people.
What?
Dr. Ethel's very frail right now, but she can recommend people who can help.
Maybe we can get in contact with her and ask if there's somebody who knows well and who would be willing to come. Okay, if you can do that, that would be wonderful. Because I'd love to have that as part of what we're doing. As you can see, this stuff, even though it's not science in the strict sense, they think it's science. And the reason they think it is science is because there's a project right now that intends to get rid of miracles of any kind. And Moses going through the Red Sea is a miracle. So if you have a Moses who actually could have written the Old Testament, or the first five books anyway, then you have to answer, well, how did he get it so wrong?
Yeah.
And that's not a comfortable question for them. And so this is why they try to write it in such a way that really there's no miracles. And for those of you who are interested, maybe in another talk, I'll bring up a quote that says precisely this is the advantage of higher criticism of the Old Testament, is that it gets rid of miracle and allows this to be a natural development of religion. You read it and suddenly, I think, at least for some people, your eyes will be opened to the controversy involved. Yes?
So why get rid of miracles? I know it's obvious, but why?
Well, because if your worldview does not want a God, and there are various reasons for that, then it's just comfortable if there aren't miracles, because miracles kind of require a God, or gods, one of the two. One of the reasons, of course, that's given is that the problem of evil is so bad that it's just easier if you don't have a God and you can believe that's just fate hitting me instead of God's allowing me to have cancer. God's allowing wars to go on. God allowed 6 million Jews and however many other million people to be killed. It's a way of getting away from the implications of the problem of evil for the character of God. That's one thing. There's another one, and that is that the problem of evil on earth is. If I can say, pales in comparison with the problem of people burning forever in hell. And it's a way of getting away from that problem, too. And finally, there is the, you know, I want to do what I want to do on Saturday night, and I don't want God looking over my shoulder. And there are people like Aldous Huxley who said that up front.
It seems that the entire planet believes in the supernatural now, except for maybe a few professors on the West and East Coast and a few in Europe.
Well, that's...
But I mean, the whole entertainment world, everyone... I mean, atheists play with supernatural.
They do.
So, I mean, along with many people, most people.
Well, I think that the time
so
of the
supernatural
professors...
is separate. I mean...
Yeah. I think that the time of the supernatural holding sway in academia is limited.
I think I don't know who is going to be left to have discussions about the lack of supernatural, because how do you separate supernatural from miracles? I mean, people don't believe in God necessarily in the educated world. They believe in supernatural for sure, and they have scenarios that go with it.
Oh, yeah. What you saw in the Red Sea was actually space aliens coming down, and their spaceships and transporting people across. Maybe there was a giant tidal wave that allowed the Israelites to get through.
Well, I'm very serious in what I'm saying.
No, I am serious too. I mean,
it's not a joke. The educated people do believe in the supernatural. Many. there's a few that are left, but that's different than God.
The truth of the matter is that paradigm is no longer holding as much water as it used to. And that's one of the reasons why you hear the screams from those people, is because they realize history is not on their side. And they're afraid that the bad guys are going to take over the universities. Pardon me? Well, yeah, and you see, if you have somebody like Trump, suddenly they're not even in control of the political establishment anymore either, and that scares them half to death.
You just make an executive order. You stop believing in evolution.
Well, no, it's not going to happen that way, I don't think. But we'll see. I really think that the next thing that's coming down the pike is not going to be atheism. It's going to be an evolution that God directed, that vitiates the need for the Sabbath, but that satisfies people's need for the supernatural, which is becoming more and more evident with time. That's what I think is going to happen. Go ahead, and then.
I was just going to comment as why people have trouble with some of the miracle stories. And I speak for myself. It's just very hard to relate any of these things happening now as these big things. I mean, it would be very big if somebody got into a fish and all this sort of thing. And the Exodus crossing and all of this. I mean, these are not happening today. And so I think for myself in the past, anyway, this has been a hurdle. But all the other things you're saying about the supernatural, it's more of a personal thing now. I mean, the seances and all sorts of stuff.
Yes.
But and also the fear of the burning hell that's taught by Christians is a big thing. But for a Christian personally, it's a little hard to understand the story of Jonah and everything unless you take it as a metaphor. I don't know.
Well, the Hebrews were not really big on doing metaphor of that kind.
No, they were very concrete.
And I rather suspect that Jonah had to be kind of...
Why aren't you seeing these things today? Why didn't someone come and rescue the people, the Christians that were stuck in the mountain?
That's one of the questions that comes up is, what about the Christians who are persecuted in the Middle East? Why doesn't God, just slaughter the armies like he did with the Syrian army? I don't know the answer to that. And I think when I say that, I am realizing that means that somebody can use that as an argument that God doesn't really exist, because if he did, he would fix things. And it's a tough question. I do think there are answers, but they're not comfortable answers. Yes, and then back to you.
A little two-part in response to what she just said. Did you ever hear about a fisherman being found in the tummy of a whale in Newfoundland many, 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 many years ago, after 2-3 days?
Yeah, I think that.
Yeah, and he was alive. So
I mean, it's not impossible.
Yeah, it's not impossible.
But it is.
It'd be filled with some slimy stuff, but there's oxygen.
However, I'm going to point out one thing, and that is that. After all of this is settled, if we were to be able to find implausible but designable things that could have happened to Jonah, maybe even to the Israelites at the Red Sea, that somehow the sea got sucked out, and when we come to the resurrection of Jesus, you are stuck. You've got to confront it head on, because I'm sorry, been dead over 24 hours, he's not coming back. Just not.
Just not.
And Lazarus 3 days. But Jesus is attested historically. And so what it is going to come down to is, does your worldview allow for God to interfere or not? And if your worldview will allow for God to interfere, there's plenty of evidence that Jesus was resurrected. If your worldview won't allow for it, then you will find some explanation, no matter how strained, to somehow explain most of the facts and then wave your hand over the last few.
Jesus made a statement I was looking for. It says, when the Son of Man comes back, will he find faith in the world? Well, are we seeing a paradigm shift now to pseudo-faith? Emilio Kinnickley used to say, you can miss target by 1 inch, you can miss it by 1 mile. We have still missed the target. So Jesus says, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith in the world? At the same time, we're seeing, a lot of faith. People are saying, this makes sense, but do they really truly believe? I think that's the question.
Yes. I want to pass it back.
I've often wondered if the problem is that people don't want to be accountable to God.
Okay, well, I will say two things. One of them is, for some people, that is true. And for those people, there is no reaching them until their situation gets bad enough that they will accept the trade-off of accountability for either truth or help, or both. In the end, the devil already knows the truth, and he's just, we're not going there. And when he finally has to go there, he still won't want what happens.
But he wants as many with him as he possible.
And he does. But I want to point out that there are other people who have always been told that we've got it wrapped up, that really this miracle stuff doesn't need to be there. And for those people, don't approach them like they just are willfully disregarding the truth, because some of them aren't. And there are other people who are upset at, God burning people forever because they cursed their mother once or something. And they were nice people otherwise. And for those people, you have to apply a third approach. So it's not one size fits all, and you need to find out which general category these people are and what their particular twists on that category are before you start reaching them, because it's not going to do you any good if you just apply all the same. Well, I wouldn't say not going to do you any good. If you're lucky, they're in the group you think they're in, and you can reach them. But if you're not lucky, you may do more harm than good.
Speaking of the supernatural triggered my thinking. I was doing a research paper on Mother Anne and the Shakers in England, and I read about their move to the United States, set up a colony, and the children experienced visitations by notable people, historic people, Indian chiefs, who came and related to the little children, up to a point when they announced that they would no longer be coming to the little Shaker village, because they were going out into every village and town in the United States to start the spiritualist movement. Shortly thereafter, the Fox sisters had their rapping with old Splitfoot, and we've had spiritualism as an accepted religion ever since.
Well, there are all kinds of interesting historical coincidences that don't get put in standard history or even history of religion, that perhaps should, and maybe that's part of our job, is to try to put some of those back in, or at least some of our job. Yes.
About 10 years ago, Peter L. Berger, the sociologist, wrote a book called The Desecularization of the World. And each chapter was written by somebody from a different area of the world, and how, for example, Buddhism was becoming more conservative, Islam is becoming more conservative, Christianity is becoming more conservative. And there were about 10 chapters with evidences from various religions around the world. But it was done to a scholarly audience, not to a popular audience. But at the same time, there were evidences in this country, at least, of the growth of the idea that you don't need God out there someplace because you are God. God is within you, and the strength and power of all you need is within you. And I think that we have not paid close enough attention to this phenomenon, and we're seeing it exhibited in multiple venues, even within the church, and through a new form of spirituality where relationship is important, but truth is not. And I think all of these things kind of relate together, and I think that we kind of need to be aware of what's happening in the religious world, around the world, in all the religions, and with this trend towards conservatism and toward control. If a conservatism, not in the good sense that says I stick to the Bible, not that kind of conservatism, but a conservatism that says that I will control you.
That's interesting. They made the case in a scholarly way, and it's diametrically opposed to the, what I would say is the dominant, still the dominant, narrative, I think you'd say, of the, of what styles themselves as a scholarly world. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you were to go to most places and get your standard history of religion, that would not be the story that they would try to portray. And that is fascinating to me, because what it says is, we have what is now becoming known as alternative facts. Fake news, yes, exactly.
We've always had alternative facts. I did not sleep with that woman. Oh, well, I didn't know I was.
Yeah. Well, didn't sleep with her, but did some other things with her that are whatever. Anyway. No, and the truth of the matter is, it's interesting because both sides, it's in some senses the pot calling the kettle black, because there are alternative facts in that universe too.
Yeah, remember the vast
right-wing conspiracy? Yes, yeah. Yes, I do. I do. We have a couple of comments over here who have been quiet so far. Way, and then we get you both.
Thank you. I've been nursing a bad cold for 3 weeks plus, and I have just woken up to hear Sister Anita Oliver say about this issue, the phenomenon of the emergence of enforceable truth. And on the other hand,
you grew up with that, didn't you?
And on the other hand, here within our church, we are basically hearing this idea that only love is all that's important. Right? Well, we have truth and we have love. If you've got truth without love, then you've got, how should I say, like a dangerous instrument in the hand of a madman.
One could call it legalism if one wanted to.
Yes, but it shrivels up a life. There cannot be life that way.
I've heard somebody comment about dry as the hills of Gilboa.
There you go. On the other hand, if you've got love without truth, all you have is a pie in the sky. And we in the Adventist Church have suffered because we have tended to swing either one way or the other. And in both cases, we have given ammunition to those who are prone to extremism, either to the left or to the right. I have discovered something very interesting. When you combine love with truth, then these, how should I say, fanatical groups become utterly disempowered. What's more, when you have a church that embraces truth with love, such fanatical groups will run away from it like you wouldn't believe. It's incredible. I was in a church where for a while we were blessed with just the right combination. And I saw several groups try to invade it with some extremist ideas. They found no traction whatsoever.
They probably went off on their own.
Oh, yes, nobody had to tell them what to do. They just left looking for more fertile territory. Do you see what the problem is?
It may be the solution.
Well, yes, but I mean the problem is that we have not embraced truth with love. Instead, we seem to want one somehow against the other. And then we go too far in that direction, and then we now want to correct, and then we bail on truth, and now we want love. You know, and that becomes like a seesaw, like the pendulum that goes around without ever having a point.
Yeah.
Well.
Ariel. Oh, okay.
I'm uninspired this morning.
Okay. Well, next week we'll talk about the mathematical proof of God, and then after that we'll get a talk by a world-class expert on creation in Revelation. So don't forget 2 weeks from today to come back for John Pauline.